Durban today. Welcome to this edition of The Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasaja. We hope out there you're sanitizing. We hope you're social distancing. We hope you're wearing your mask because COVID-19 is real and it is still ravaging our society. For the categories of Ugandans that qualify for the vaccine, please you go and do take your jab because we don't have very many options and we need you alive. Now, on The Checkpoint tonight, we are going to be talking about financing social protection in the face of COVID-19 and a constrained resource envelope. And our guest tonight is a policy analyst and a coordinator, Uganda Parliamentary Forum on Social Protection, Mr. Patrick Katabazi. Welcome to the show.
The pleasure is mine, and greetings to our viewers and listeners.
So, Patrick, when so many times when we talk about social protection, what comes to the minds of many is social security in terms of retirement benefits. But for the benefit of the viewer, could you help us expound on what exactly is social protection beyond retirement benefits and social security needs?
Yes, social protection includes all that we have talked about. But in summary, we are talking about interventions, programs, and plans of both private and public sector aimed at mitigating shocks and vulnerabilities that face the citizenry or the people. So all those programs, plans, and activities, whether they are undertaken by private sector or public sector, but as long as the overall objective is to build the resilience of people to overcome shocks, risks, and vulnerabilities that come with the life cycle, all that is called social protection. Social security part that includes social insurance, such as NSSF, another form of retirement benefits programs have been very prominent in Uganda over the last so many years, but we are also beginning to see other non-social insurance programs that one would call social care that are taking shape, and that might include social assistance grants for empowerment, the grant for older persons, and many other grants, like we saw recently the money that was given, 100,000, to the vulnerable to cushion them against the effects of COVID-19, popularly known as Nebanja money. So all those are forms of social protection. We also have a public works program that is taking place in eastern Uganda and some parts of northern Uganda. And in this particular case is that government and development partners are making money available to people who otherwise would be jobless, but there is money that is available for cash for work. You work on a government program, it could be on a road, it could be clearing the bush around the government installation, and you get paid. And that is also some form of social protection, in a sense that ordinarily that payment won't be there, or that program wouldn't be there under normal government operations, but they are specifically putting it there to get people to work.
So, it's deliberate to get
a specific category of people to get work who otherwise won't be having employment. So there are quite a number of programs, as we shall see, but those are a few examples that we can highlight when you talk about social protection. So in essence, social protection are all programs that are looking at uplifting the people. We're not talking about roads here. We're not talking about building health centers. We're not talking about building. We're talking about any program that is looking at improving the standard of the people, but also ensuring that once they have attained a set standard, they do not fall back in case there's a turbulence that might come resulting from drought, as an example, from war, from any other instability like COVID that has come, sickness, and loss of employment.
So you make a very interesting point when you say making sure that they do not fall back. I'll give you the example of, let me say, the people of Bududa. time and again, when they're affected by floods, our government resettles them in a certain place. They start programs, farming programs for them. They give them a few of their basic needs to start life. But then, long before we know, they are falling back into the same circumstances. What would you call this then?
Yes, when there is Bududa, when we have had landslides from the recent experience, from the past experience, it's been the case that government normally comes in to provide relief, then resettle them. I think that's part of social protection. Yes. Response to disaster is also a social protection.
It's part of social protection, but the concept of not falling back.
But our approach to disaster response has not been holistic, has not been very comprehensive. And that, in a way, has created circumstances that you are talking about, where you have Bududa hit, you still have the same crisis that you will have when it hits, when the landslides hit the following day. So what do we need to see? We need to have a predictable response plan for mud slides in Mount Elgon area, in Mount Wezori area, and some parts of Western Uganda, particularly in the Gezi mountains. Why do I say so? Because it has now become very predictable. Bududa has become very predictable that possibly after every 2 years, we have the same scenario repeating itself. River Nyamwamba bursting, it's almost an annual song that keeps playing. Yes, roads, mudslide cutting off roads and some villages in Kabale, Kisoro area, and Rubanda now is becoming a thing that is repetitive. So now what we need to have is a clear-cut response plan that takes care of this predictable pattern that has come, so that now you know that River Nyamwamba tends to burst in a particular season. So before it does, or when it does, you're already on ground to take care of the emerging issues. You know that after every year, after every 2 years possibly, Bududa mudslides in the Bududa Mount Elgon area are going to become prevalent. So you as government, you as duty bearers, what mitigation plans do you have in place, so that you do not act as if these things are happening as emergencies, because it will no longer be an emergency anymore. It will simply be a disaster response. So we already say, okay, from emergency to a disaster-prone scenario. So once you have classified it as a disaster-prone area, then you no longer now need to talk about emergency. Because now you already know this is a disaster area. Every 2 years, every 3 years, every 4 years, something of this nature will happen. And then that will possibly eliminate some of the shortfalls that we are seeing in our response plan.
Time and again, when someone talks about the Uganda Parliamentary Forum on Social Protection, what comes to the minds of so many people is that SAGE program, the program for that supports the elder. But I understand that under the Ministry of General Labour and Social Development, there is that unit called the Expanding Social Protection, program. What is it about? And when you talk about expanding social protection programs, my understanding is that it is broader than the way the forum is described as the SAGE forum and all that. And how far has it gone in ensuring that it is expanding social protection?
Now, the characterization of SAGE as being social protection, either social protection program or the expanded social protection program, the one that is being implemented by government, I think is not a mistake, but it is erroneous. It's not a mistake, number one, because SAGE, the Social Assistance Government for Empowerment, was or is government of Uganda's flagship program. So this is a program they started implementing in 2011 as a flagship program. It's the one that has taken the flag for social protection interventions in this country. And we thank government for that. And therefore, you will notice that from 2011 to date, most of the debate on social protection has been around SAGE.
Yes.
And it was around SAGE because even to get to this level, there were quite a number of complications. So that's why the song became extremely prominent. In 2011, it was a pilot for 5 years to 2016. So now after the pilot phase, there was debate to whether we disband it or whether we extend it. And if we extended it, to what extent would it go? Because the initial pilot districts were 14, and then Yumbe was added on in 2014, so they became 15. So what will become of other districts? So then it went into a phased rollout, targeting an additional 30 districts, which made them 55 districts. But of course, then that set a center stage for the national rollout because it was found unfair and inequitable to have a district, to have a national program running in a few districts, yet the problems affecting older persons in these particular instances were everywhere, including in all corners of all the districts that we have in the country. So that's why SAGE became prominent in our social protection debate and discussions. But social protection is broad. And the second bit of it is that expanding social protection is there as a program of government to lead implementation of these programs. And as you might have heard, in 2015, we got the social protection policy that talks about SAGES as just one of the components, but with other broad areas of focus. And I wanted to say that much as of the debate has been about SAGE, but expanding social protection directly to the Minister of Gender and also this program, ESP, has a broader mandate. The same applies now to the Uganda Parliamentary Forum on Social Protection, because like we said, social protection is broad and it follows what we would otherwise call a life cycle. That a child forms in the womb of a mother, so the mother one needs appropriate antenatal care services, including...
That's where, at conception is where social protection begins.
That's where social protection begin, ideally. So now you have the intervention targeting a mother, to ensure that a mother produces a child that is healthy, but also the mother keeps life as well, because we've heard of maternal death and many other challenges that come with it. So then a child is born. So there are many interventions there. In many countries, you hear about the child grant, child nutrition program. Then, of course, education programs set in at that stage. So the child, meanwhile, is growing and is becoming a youth, so to speak. So there are many other programs that come into that. There are apprenticeships there. There is, of course, advanced education there. There are other skill-based programs that are put in place. And then from the youthful stage, of course, at that point, somebody is being oriented now into the working life. So you become a worker now, adult. So there are two entry points here, possibly three. You can join formal employment, you can be in informal employment, or you can be self-employed. You can work for yourself. So there are three entry points. So then at that stage then, there are also social protection interventions around that. So do you have the right skill? You would have addressed that one before, but you can get refresher. But are you earning adequate income? In other countries, they have income enhancement programs. Like if you're earning below a certain minimum, there's a top-up that government gives you. But then also if you get unemployed, if you are in formal employment or otherwise, but you are deemed unemployed for a specific period of time, then you get government support. All those are social protection programs. But also it is at that stage that also the other wider debate of social insurance comes in. Are you making your contribution to the NSSF? Are you under any other pension program? Because then you are starting to now work for the other aspect of life that we are here to talk about, and that is the old age. And of course, then you die. So that is social protection. So for us to be viewed as a social protection advocacy entity, our approach to social protection must reflect the realities around the human life, how somebody gets born and how they exit this world. And so should be the benchmark that we should be testing government on and its expanding social protection program and many other programs of that nature, whether they are part and parcel of that whole life cycle system. Because if they don't, it means that we will have mismatches. I'll give an example. Uganda has a very young population right now. So, and we have SEG, which is providing cushion for older persons who are incapable because of the nature of the circumstances. And they are getting a cash grant of 25,000 every month. But there are very few, I should say, compared to the number of youth who are about 75% who are below possibly 40 years old right now. So if we do not have correct social protection interventions right now, it means that the dependency will be extremely high when these guys exit this stage and then go into the older person's bracket.
Patrick, that is a very interesting conversation that I want us to have. But I'm going to drag you a little bit back on the SEG. One, I want you to help us paint a picture of this 25, when you talk about 25,000 shillings for a mother, a grandparent who is 70 years old, they have three dependents probably. Do you think, in your assessment, do you think this money, do you think this stipend has been able to make an impact on the lives of the people? Because what I'm asking is because there has been agitation, one, for it to expand, like you said, from the 14 districts to 15 to the entire country. So I need to understand, has it been able to impact on the lives of the people, the beneficiaries that are targeted? But also secondly, what kind of reforms should we be discussing at this time?
SEG has been extremely successful from where I stand. Mm. Not certainly many people do where I stand, because I've been exposed to field visits where this program has been implemented.
But you've been in the thick of it. So
I've been in the thick of it, like you've said. Mm. I've been part of evaluation surveys that have brought results that indicate that the nutrition levels, for example, of older persons have gone up. You see, and that in most communities, the welfare of the older persons has gone up. There are, of course, concerns that the money we are talking about is extremely small, and that in Kampala that cannot even buy a meal at Cafe Javas and at many other places around town. But a common person, what has come out is that this money has become a shot in the arm, to the extent that for where older persons have had something small, this money has come in as a huge addition. Some have hired labor to till the land, because you remember at that age, you don't even have energy to till the land. Some have invested in assets, buying something small, a hen, a goat, and the multiplier effect has been seen. Some have made this money accumulate and have improved on their housing. And SEG is an example of how small grants can transform society. But beyond the benefits that accrue to an individual beneficiary, pumping money into the economy is now the new paradigm. You've heard of the USA president saying that the top-bottom economics has failed, that it is now the right time to talk about bottom-up economics. And I'm one of the people subscribe in that narrative. that you don't expect to give money or a tax waiver
to
a company with hope that yes, with the hope that that money will somehow find its way in Kabera Maido. Impossible. You need to take the money to Kabera Maido there, and people feel it. And what are we talking about? We are talking about a circular flow of income that has meaning. And indeed, in Katakwi, I think, in 2014, the research did indicate that about 20 million every month, that would be every payday, would be in a sub-county, in one of the, averagely in one of the sub-counties, circulating.
Yes.
That means that the economics of that sub-county will have improved by benefiting from that 20 million that is circulating, which otherwise would never have come if there wasn't a program like that. So it means that if you have a shop, you can sell.
Apparently, I have a friend that comes from there. He's called Patrick Ochaido, and he was, you would help us expound on that. He was telling me, you don't know that the significance of an old man sitting at Malwa Port with his 5,000. Does this trigger happiness in society? And is that something that we can bank on if we are talking about social protection, having a happy society?
Yes, having a, yes, is part, I mean, because you see what is happening is that here what we are trying to do, what social protection actually does, is to ensure that somebody can have a dignified exit.
Yes.
Because, I mean, we are not immortal. All of us at some stage will exit. But how are you going to exit? So one of the reasons why some actually people die so young are related to emotional issues, emotional distress, relating to incapacity to perform certain roles and responsibilities. So some people were saying that, okay, you are giving people to money, you are giving people money, some of these are going to go to the Marua ports and then drink it. And I'm one of the people who said, that's fine. Maybe that's what is going to make you live for an extra day. Because, I mean, you could be there in your home, in the bed, which possibly would be a very poor bed. You don't have any means to take you to a trading center. And it is possibly maybe that has taken you to a trading center that will give you a lease of life. That you get an opportunity to talk to your peers, also get an opportunity to blag here and there, and maybe that's what makes life. Conversely, another person will say, okay, maybe I have washed my clothes, I've not had soap for so long, so I'm going to go to the church this time round and sit in front. And maybe that's psychology.
A portion of sugar, a portion of soap.
Yes, that's that part of psychology that will make your life happier, that will make you hope to live for another day. And for me, I think social protection of that, and including the importance of those social assistance grants, that's what come in handy. But you also asked a very important question. What are the missing gaps in policy? What could have been done differently? Yes, for now, I think Uganda, generally speaking, by any standards, we are still at early stages of state formation. Some people would want to have other ideas. So, but
it's
still,
a fact.
Yes, we are still at an early age, an early stage of state formation and of development in many ways. And as such, there's a lot that we could do. Social protection debate became very prominent after the World War and the economic depression, of course, of 1932. When you look at the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and all other conventions on international labor organization, these are 1940s. So in 1940s, people were having a debate about what we are talking about today. Imagine. For us, this debate started yesterday. But these other guys started this debate in 1940s. And that, of course, got transformed into the Universal Declaration of Human Rights that states that every person should be entitled to some form of social security. And they highlight social security, of course, about maternal health, about labor rights, your employment benefits, about health, you know, and about pension. So that was so many years ago, about 70 or 80 plus years ago. So, but for us, this debate is becoming very prominent. And that explains the reason why some people don't understand it. So, but now that we are having it on the national stage right now, we should be thinking, in my view, in life cycle approach. That will include revising our national social protection policy. It has been in operation since 2015, so there are a lot of emerging areas that need to be looked at. We need to have a social protection strategy. As a country right now, we don't. So we need to have a social protection strategy anchored on other planning instruments like the National Development Plan, the Vision 2040, because the Vision 2040, the National Development Plan, all of them really have articulated the vision for this country, for the development of this country. And I think they are spot on. And social protection is one of the core components of our development strategy. So, but we need to have a strategic direction in how that gets transformed into realistic programs and activities, so that at the end of the day, we get a clear map of where we are going. So that then might include thinking around programs for supporting mothers and early childhood, and then youth, then the working population of any form, whether it is self-employed, informal sector, and formal sector. And of course, when it comes to formal sector, our message here is that we don't want to see Ugandans, including myself, paying for my own social security, but also paying for a civil servant. They should also pay for their own social security as well. Because they are also like me. I work in private sector. I pay for my...
For your social security.
Yes, for my NSSF. Mm. But I also pay for a civil servant by subsidizing, because for them they don't make any contribution. And here we are saying, as part of government strategy, we should see a very fast reform in the public pension, public service pension, to make it contributory as well. We have members of parliament, as an example, who are into a contributory pension scheme, and it is working very well. And that should be a good message, that even people in the informal sector should start thinking very, very seriously about making a contribution. Some people want to make quality saving, but we can, for the purpose of just quality contribution, making a contribution to their own social security. The Baganda say, I don't know whether that's the correct way, but something of the sort. So we need that one to be reflected at all levels, whether I'm working in self-employment, informal sector, and possibly formal sector, whether I'm in public service. So we need that message to be very well articulated in all the government policies and plans around social protection. So the reforms I'm talking about, the policies I'm talking about, should be mapping that. And because if we miss, we are a very young population, one of the countries with the highest population growth rate. So if we, for instance, miss that opportunity, like right now, we'll have a highly dependent old age that possibly government, our taxes cannot be able to finance. Because it means if you're not highly productive, you cannot create your income that can be able to make these contributions that we're talking about. But more importantly, you cannot even get good jobs because possibly you've not been trained well.
And but Patrick, isn't that a reality? Because the benefits, the contributions and all that we are talking about presupposes that I'm working whether in the informal sector or formal or informal sector. But you have the largest chunk of Ugandans that are of productive age, but are really not productive. They are either unemployed or underemployed. Isn't that the reality? And how do we deal with it?
Yes, that's the reality. And I'm cognizant of that. But I also know from the other social protection interventions, including some peripheral social protection programs like the Youth Livelihood Program, I hear the Myoga Program, the Women Entrepreneurship Program, the Parish Development Model. I think all that is an attempt to reverse that situation. And I hope those programs work. And also hope that the people implementing this program share the same vision. Because if we don't share the same vision, we'll simply be implementing programs left, right, and center, and we're not going to have any visible impact. But I also want to say that we're also seeing some policy shift in these areas. For example, the debate around NSSF now includes opening up to informal sector. We also know that Cabinet has approved principles for social security programs for purely informal sector as well. So the debate is taking shape. But we need to have a natural progression to this, because also some of these concepts, if we really just rush into them, sometimes we may have some haphazard program implementation. So, but the thing is that we need to have people understand these, connect the dots. I'll give an example. For example, SAGE in itself addresses child development outcomes. How? Most of the orphans and vulnerable children stay with with older persons. So if you support the older persons here, there will be unintended, possibly, beneficiaries.
Is it deliberate or it's just an occurrence?
Right now it is possibly not an intention. This is purely for older persons. But you realize that as you implement this program, it has these linkages. So it is very, very important that in implementing OMP programs, we create these linkages and take advantage of them. So that, because you see, it may not be possible to have really everything happening at the same time. But when a government program happens, can we create these linkages? Can we take advantage of them? So that at the end of the day, our investment, no matter how small it can be, it will have a wider multiplier effect.
Okay. With that, we are going to go for a very short break. And when we return, we shall talk about how best we can finance social protection in the face of the adverse effects of COVID-19 and a very small economy with competing demands. But first, let's break.